Old pirates, yes, they rob I, sold I to the merchant ships. Minutes after they took I from the bottomless pit. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever had, redemption songs, redemption songs, redemption songs.
Havana is a fine example of Spanish colonial architecture. For nearly 400 years, Cuba was the pearl of the Spanish Antilles. And long after independence, Spaniards continued to settle here. And as you walk through the streets, you notice that unlike other islands, the majority of Cubans are mulatto, not black. It's the most racially mixed population in the Caribbean. But it seems to me that what makes Cuba different is not the Spanish legacy or the ethnic mix, but what's happened here since the Cuban Revolution. The Museum of Arms is a monument to the violent nature of Cuba's break with the past. These are the relics of bullet-riddled assassinations and fierce guerrilla ambushes of the handful of survivors of Castro's rebel army who took on a superpower and won. It was an audacious act, and it brought us to the brink of a Third World War. Cuba is totally unlike any other island in the Caribbean. This scene simply could not happen on any other island.
Compañero combatiente internacionalista procedente de la República Popular de Angola. Nuestros heroicos combatientes internacionalistas.
Cuba was once a local dictatorship corrupted by its long dependency on America. But since Castro's overthrow of the dictator Batista, this island of only 10 million people has shoehorned itself onto the international stage, deployed its troops on missions across the globe, and welcomed them home like revolutionary heroes. The economy is in desperate straits, especially now that the Soviets are rethinking their foreign commitments. But as if money were no object, Cuban doctors, teachers, agronomists, and soldiers carry the revolutionary word to far-flung outposts. Ever since Che Guevara was killed fighting a guerrilla war in the Bolivian jungles, Cubans have exported their revolution with missionary zeal. Every Cuban is taught from childhood that the Third World struggles are Cuba's struggles too. As Soviet foreign policy became more cautious, Cuba took on the vanguard role in world revolutionary struggle. I watched these 700 soldiers return from Angola aboard the Soviet troop ship Ivan Franco. Each soldier has been issued with his campaign medals and two flags, the flags of Cuba and Angola. According to Cubans, these returning soldiers are not conscripted mercenaries, they're volunteers. When Cuban volunteers turned up in Jamaica in the 1960s to build a school, they frightened the life out of everyone. This army was sent to help Angola resist the threatening embrace of South Africa. They're tough veterans of a two-year war in the African scrubland. They finally succeeded in sapping South Africa's will to fight on, perhaps Castro's greatest military and diplomatic moment. No wonder Cuba has a special place in the hearts of the Caribbean's black population. This is what makes Cuba unique, her internationalism. Other Caribbean islands, preoccupied with their own problems, seem parochial in comparison. They lack this heroic sense of commitment. It's astonishing how deeply this belief in Cuba's world mission has rooted itself in just 30 years. The official welcome continues as the troops are bused to Revolution Square. It's hard to doubt the depth of patriotic feeling, at least among the crowds gathered here. This patriotism has held Cuba together against her external enemies. They now pay homage to the national hero, José Martí, the man who led Cuba's struggle for independence from Spain and Fidel's inspiration, long before Lenin. The events at the quayside and in Revolution Square are reported in full in the next day's Granma, Cuba's state-controlled communist daily paper, named in memory of the leaky boat which transported Fidel's tiny rebel band from Mexico. The Angola story is of particular interest to Marlene Diaz, for today's a day of special importance in her life. Most Cuban women go out to work. Until now, Marlene has had no need to earn a living because she's married to a cyclist in Cuba's national team and is relatively well off. But news has reached her of an opportunity not to be missed. She leaves her Havana suburb and makes for the city center for an audition. Marlene completes her audition with a reading from the lead story in the national news.
Noticias nacionales. Regresó a Cuba otro grupo de más de 700 combatientes internacionalistas. La base del monumento a nuestro héroe nacional, José Martí, en la Plaza de la Revolución, sirvió de sede al acto de recibimiento a los más de 700 combatientes internacionalistas cubanos que en la mañana de ayer regresaron victoriosos a la patria, tras cumplir honrosamente su misión en la hermana República Popular de Angola.
Continuando el proceso eleccionario, como es costumbre y tradicional,
Marlene is one of several readers, and when they've all been auditioned, the tobacco workers are invited to elect, by a show of hands, the reader of their choice. The right to a say in the working conditions in factories like these is part of the Cuban-style popular democracy which Castro introduced. Perhaps it helps to compensate for the lack of formal democracy and free elections.
Bien, bajen la mano. Por la compañerita Marlene Díaz. Bien, bajen la mano. Como han visto los compañeros, ha sido elegida en votación casi unánime la compañerita Marlene Díaz. Muchas gracias.
Next to the famous Hotel Nacional is the monument to those Americans who died when their ship Maine blew up in Havana Harbor in 1898. It gave America the excuse to intervene directly in Cuba's war of independence against Spain, and later, actually to alter Cuba's constitution so that America had a permanent say in Cuban affairs. Cuba became an offshore dependency, an American plantation and playground. Cuban workers were cheap labor, Cuban women cheap playthings. Some of the hotel staff remember when America's puppet dictatorship allowed the mafia to do what it pleased in Havana.
Este, un mundo aquí dentro del Hotel Nacional era una belleza, todo era una gloria, y afuera era terrible por los crímenes que se usaba por la tiranía de aquella época. Nosotros, que éramos jóvenes en aquel tiempo, teníamos muchas dificultades en la salida de este hotel. En los momentos que nosotros salíamos, veíamos a los jóvenes en la calle con 4 o 5 tiros en la cabeza. Cuando regresábamos el otro día, aquí en el hotel era una alegría, roleta, prostitución, esto era terrible.
There isn't much in the film archives about what conditions were like here before the revolution. The Batista regime wasn't much interested in chronicling the debased life of an island that was virtually an American colony, with rural poverty widespread and Havana, the brothel of the Caribbean. But there is one telling piece of film which shows the humiliation of Cuba that fueled its anti-American feeling. In 1949, a group of drunk U.S. Marines urinated on the statue of José Martí, who is to Cuba what George Washington is to the United States. The U.S. ambassador, Robert Butler, made this filmed apology to the outraged Cuban people.
I want to take this occasion to apologize to the Cuban people on behalf of the American people for the incident that happened last evening at the desecration of the monument of
Cuba. Ambassador Butler actually forgot the name of the patron saint of the country to which he was accredited. But Cubans didn't forget. The survivors of the Granma found support amongst the peasants in the Sierra Mountains. And after a long and bloody guerrilla war, Fidel and Che entered Havana.
When the revolution came, the Americans left. Then followed the Bay of Pigs fiasco, the Cuban Missile Crisis, and America discovered that instead of a compliant client, she had a hardline, Soviet-backed, communist state a mere 90 miles from Florida. Behind me over there is all that's left of the American presence in Havana. It used to be the embassy. It's not that anymore, at least not in name. Now it's known as the American Interests Office. And when the U.S. officials look out of their window, they're confronted by a defiant sign lit up at night and composed in that spirit of Arctic deep freeze into which relations between Cuba and America have fallen. Mr. Imperialists, it says, we are not afraid of you. Not one little bit.
Historians agree that what cemented the support of ordinary people for the revolution were the social reforms which Castro set in train in the liberated areas, long before the outcome of the struggle was certain. The revolution's outstanding achievement remains the social services that are the envy of other Caribbean islands. There's cradle to grave welfare for all. Aerobics for the over 60s, state nurseries for all children from 6 weeks old. Infant mortality, which is such a terrible scourge elsewhere in the region, is lower than in Washington, D.C., and life expectancy is high. Fidel, they're singing, you can count on us old people. The state discipline, which is evident in the unvarying routine of the children in the daycare nursery, is part of Cuba's struggle to forge a new people, a new kind of human being, Cuba's so-called new man. We don't yet know whether these last 30 years will have permanently changed the Caribbean personality. But Che Guevara's dream has not made Cuba utopia. The endemic faults of communism are here too. No free speech, no freedom to travel, a heavy-handed secret police, and shortages, not just the haphazard ones you find in Jamaica, but as a way of life, daily more desperate as Soviet aid dries up. No one starves, but there's rationing and endless queues to buy the simplest necessities. So, will Cuba go the same way as Eastern Europe?
The majority of Cubans are Fidelista at heart. Though what sort of communists they are is another question. There is dissent here, especially among young people who take the achievements of the revolution for granted and want more liberty. But there's no glasnost here in Cuba, and it would do the critics of the regime no good at all to be heard voicing their dissent in public.
Curiously, the very shortage of consumer goods is used by the government as an incentive to model behavior among Cuban men and women. In this showroom, I saw two identical refrigerators. The one on the left would be sold to citizens who have conformed by doing the required stint of voluntary work in the countryside, voluntary time on the Revolutionary Watch committees, etc. To model citizens, this fridge costs about £500. The other fridge can be bought by non-model citizens, provided they can afford the penal markup. Luis Cortina and Eileen Gonzalez are soon to be married. She's a cartoon film animator, he's a printer. Like many Cuban couples, they met during their voluntary period of work in the countryside. When they get married, all Cuban couples are entitled to a state trousseau. Clothing, bedding, kitchen utensils, fabrics, cosmetics. All are available on production of the state ration card at a huge reduction. The problem is that the choice is poor and the quality suspect. Of course, poor people in other islands who start life with nothing may be willing to overlook this, though they'd be suspicious of the intrusive presence of the state. Not just state underpants and state lingerie, but a state wedding dress with a state train. Eileen badly needs something to wear on her 3-day state honeymoon. She's offered a dress made in Russia, designed for the ample Soviet woman. What most people resent is the way so much of life has had to conform to Eastern Europe's drab standards, losing its Caribbean color and flair. The young couple will not have a home of their own. They will live in Luis's mother's house. One day they might have their own place, particularly if they join a micro brigade. If you're wondering what a micro brigade is, this is one, a very special one, a volunteer work party. Though if they're oppressed by all this volunteering, they don't show it. This is Cuba's world champion volleyball team, arriving to do the heavy work for the skilled builders of a new apartment complex. Building your own home is Cuba's answer to the housing shortage. These athletes will get one of these flats when the block is finished. It's easy to snare at organized self-help in these post-communism days, but many Caribbean islands could do with a bit of it to overcome the legacy of underdevelopment. Luis and Eileen arrive at Havana's Palace of Marriages, which has three salons, the green, the pink, and by far the most popular, the gold. It has to be booked months in advance. Today, there's an even greater demand for the gold room because it's St. Valentine's Day. And although there's no place for saints in this atheist state, old customs die hard, and some skillful accommodations with the past have been made. February the 14th is now Hearts Day. Catholicism is still tolerated, as you'd expect in a country that was Spanish for 400 years. But the words of this wedding service have a socialist flavor and incorporate the state family code, which enshrines the equality of women.
El otro cónyuge contribuirá por sí solo a la expresada subsistencia sin perjuicio del deber de cooperar a dichos trabajos y cuidados. Y artículo 28 dice que ambos cónyuges tienen derecho a ejercer sus profesiones u oficios y están en el deber de prestarse recíprocamente cooperación y ayuda para ello, así como para emprender estudios o perfeccionar sus conocimientos, pero cuidarán en todo caso de organizar la vida en el hogar, de modo que tales actividades se coordinen con el cumplimiento de las obligaciones que este código les impone. Así que leído los artículos del Código de Familia, Yo pregunto, Luis, ¿usted persiste en la resolución de formalizar su matrimonio con Yelén, sí o no?
Sí.
Yelén, ¿y usted persiste en la resolución de formalizar su matrimonio con Luis?
Sí.
Bien, pues. Bueno, Luis y Yelén ahora sí están casados. En nombre de nuestra sociedad socialista que todos estamos construyendo, los declaro unidos en legítimo matrimonio. Muchas felicidades le deseo a los dos, me deseo que sean muy felices.
Gracias.
Aquí tienen el tomo y el folio de su matrimonio. Y antes de irse, yo les doy el carnet de identidad actualizado,
¿sabes?
Until they manage to get their own home, Luis and Eileen may be spending some of their afternoons here, in the Pasadas, open 24 hours a day. If you're over 16, a room will cost $9, no questions asked. Critics of the regime point out that this greater openness about sexuality goes hand in hand with official harassment of homosexuals. Many couples have no privacy for lovemaking, but some come here simply because it's more spacious, cleaner, more comfortable than their own homes. Couples while away the hours in the Posadas, slowly moving up the list until they reach the top. Then, when a room falls vacant, they can at last do what is denied them in their own homes. The Havana skyline hasn't changed much in 30 years. Here and there, a tower block reminds us of the long American presence in the city. Stroll along the Malecón. It's a living museum of vintage American cars, Buicks, Plymouths, Studebakers. A film set from the 1950s.
Since the premiere of our nightclub, Jackson is Sum Sum Dam Bai.
Este lugar se llamó Villa Mina.
Or taking a show. Could this be Castro's Cuba, prudish, puritanical, priggish?
1939. But that same night, San Juan players sang a very particular one. That beautiful melody was the origin of our name.
The Tropicana nightclub is celebrating its 50th birthday, and not much seems to have changed. Cuba is trying to boost its foreign earnings. The dollar will buy anything here. And the tables are full of tourists who pay hard currency to feast their eyes on Cuba's long-legged dream girls. But the Tropicana is a trip down memory lane to a place which the revolution never reached. It's all much the same as it was when Douglas Fairbanks and the Duke and Duchess of Windsor dropped in for a night out. Nostalgia is all around. The ghosts of Carmen Miranda, Nat King Cole, and Frank Sinatra linger in the shadows. The show is a hymn of praise to the good old, bad old days.
Habana, paraíso encantado.
But outside, things have changed. The trade embargo which the Americans imposed has seen to that. In the old days, 90% of the cars were American. But since then, no spare parts have been able to get through the blockade. Today, among the Russian Ladas and Moscoviches which replaced them, these veterans still wheeze along on the wing and the prayer. One of the most powerful symbols of achievement for poor people in the Caribbean is the motor car. But in Cuba, cars also symbolize something else, the very complicated relationship between Cuba and North American culture, a relationship which Cuba now shares with all its Caribbean neighbors. Daniel Ferrara is a taxi driver. He's 74. He's owned his Chevrolet Bel Air for over 30 years.
Ya no hay pieza, aquí no hay pieza. Porque los Estados Unidos no fabrica parte para estos carros. No, problema nunca. Entonces los domingos, yo le dedico toda la mañana a limpiarlo y hacerle toda la fobería que yo tengo que hacer. Estando arriba de él continuamente y no abandonarlo cuando se afloja un tornillo, apretarlo. Sí, el delirio mío es tenerlo así bonito, para que la gente del pasaje se sienta cómodo. A la niña linda, esta es la niña linda. Mi segunda esposa. La prueba de este carro, si yo le tengo cariño, que todos los días tengo 1,000,000 de compradores. Uno ofrece 20, otro 30, otro 32, otro 33. Pero yo, este carro no se vende por ningún dinero. Este tiene que enterrarme. Bueno, hace 32 años que está conmigo. Y él me ha salido, ya digo, muy bueno. Me ha ayudado mucho. Y nosotros hemos compartido toda la vida, parte de la vida de él y parte de la vida mía. Estamos compartiendo. Usted me dice, tú ayúdame, que yo te ayudo también. Y ahí hemos hecho un pacto de él y yo. Y nos va a la misma maravilla. Sin problema ninguno. Cuando yo no pueda manejar más, lo maneja el hijo, lo maneja el nieto. Para cuando yo sea viejo, que me saque a pasear por ahí. Celosa, sí, del carro. Sí, ella se pone celosa. Dice que yo cuido más el carro que ella.
As dusk gives way to night in Havana, Daniel is discussing an idea with his son, Daniel, and with his grandson, who is also called